A quick recap of where we're up to with this Commodore 64 restoration. It came to me with a black screen, completely dead on arrival. I checked the power supply. That seemed to be okay, the external power brick. And the next thing I did was I followed Sven's guide on the internet. I'll put a link up to that in the description. And scoped it out. I was getting some very funny signals on the 6510 here, the CPU. So I guessed the PLA had died. It was either going to be the PLA, the RAM, or one of these logic chips. So I guessed it was the PLA that had died. So remove that. Checked everything on the scope again. We're still seeing a dodgy signal on the address and data lines of the 6510. So the next step was the RAM. Desoldered the RAM. Tested that in Stephen Vickers' RAM tester. Again, I'll put a link to that in the description. They all passed. I also tested the MOS logic chips because they're a known point of failure. I tested that using the TL866 EPROM programmer's logic test feature. And one of these failed. I'm not sure which one, but one of these failed. I think the multiplexer chips were the RAM. So anyway, replaced the MOS logic with modern logic chips. Again, socketed them. And yeah, that's where we're up to. Now, you may have noticed that I've not replaced the PLA yet. There's a good reason for that. When I was testing the logic chips for the in my TL866 programmer, I got a firmware and a software update. Now, previously, logic chips have been bundled with all of the other ICs. So you just selected the logic chip, and then when you tried to program it, you got an option to test it instead of programming it. Now they've moved all of the logic into its own dedicated area. And not only can you quickly access the logic tests for standard logic chips, like 74 series logic chips, you can now define custom logic chips. And that got me thinking. The PLA is just a custom logic chip. So I asked myself the question, would it be possible for me to test the PLA in a TL866 EPROM programmer? And the answer is yes, and I'm going to show you how to do it now. So what do I need to test this PLA then? Well, obviously you need a PLA, a compatible EEPROM programmer. In this case, it's got to be a TL866II Plus EEPROM programmer with the latest version of the firmware. I'll give you the specific firmware version later. And a logic table. Now, the logic table will tell me for set inputs on the PLA what the expected outputs would be. Thankfully, that work has already been done. I've already blogged about this. There'll be a link in the description. In Volume 6, Issue 5 of the Transactor magazine, somebody has reverse engineered the PLA and given us a logic table. The logic table is presented as 26 columns of states of the PLA, and in each one of these states it will tell me for a given input what the expected outputs will be. And these are all pins on the PLA, where X is ignore, 1 and 0 are high and low. Never quite worked out what minus was. I just assumed that was ignore. And yeah, that's it. I've got a logic table. So how do I get that into the programmer then? The first thing you did was get a diagram of the pinouts of the PLA, which we've got here. And also, I inputted the truth table into an Excel spreadsheet. I kind of rotated it 90 degrees to make it a little bit easier, because the way the MiniPro software works is you enter each state as a row, not a column. So a little bit of rejigging of the truth table here. So I've got the Mini Pro software loaded. Let's get that on screen. And the version I am using is 10.61 of the Windows software, and the firmware revision on the programmer itself is 4.2.123. And just to be clear, I'm using a TL866II Plus here in order to test this. Your mileage might vary with other versions of the TLS866. So in this software, you've got a new icon here which looks like a logic symbol. If you click on that, you can see you've got a list of standard logic chips to test. You've also got a new button and a copy button. And that's what piqued my interest when I first started testing the logic chips using this. And you can see here that I've already created one for the Commodore 64 PLA, the model I've got, the 82S100. And I've copied the truth table into here, more or less, as is. The way that you enter the data is, let me create a new kit chip to show you. You first set the number of pins in your chip. So I can't remember how many it is for the PLA off the top of my head. It's 28, isn't it? So let's create a new one with 28 pins. Set the supply voltage, so it's 5 volts. You can give it a name. Let's do that now. And then you create all the line items. You do that by setting the states of the pins here. So say, for example, if I wanted to check for output 20 going high, if pins 2 and 3 were 1 and 0, I'd set that as the test. You've also got to set some control pins as well, like voltage and ground. And in the case of the PLA, you'll also need to force its chip enable pin as well. So let's go back to the my PLA one. You can see I've set ground here. G is the ground symbol. And V is VCC, which I set to 5 volts here. And I think it's this pin here. Let me have a look. 10, 19, pin 19 is chip enable. So let's just check that in the schematics now. Yep, looking at the diagram there, it's pin 19 and it's OE active low, which is why I've set that to 0. Initially when I ran the test, I forgot to set that. Obviously the chip wasn't enabled, so it wouldn't do anything if I put any inputs across it. It wouldn't output anything. And I thought I had a completely knackered PLA, but it turned out I was just being a muppet and I've not actually enabled the chip. I suggest if you want to look into this in more detail, you bob over to my website and find the blog post, again, link in the description. So let's demonstrate how this actually works in practice. Let's pop up the software on screen again. There we go. I'll open the logic test, select my custom truth table, and pop the EEPROM in, PLA in. Did I say EEPROM there? Notch at the top and run test. So fingers crossed this will pass. And there we go. It's run all of these individual line tests, all 26 of them, and applied the inputs and checked the outputs. And if the outputs match what I've specified, then it will pass that particular line. They spelled result wrong there. Bless them. Right. And it looks like then I've got a working PLA. So let's bob that back in the Commodore 64 and see whether or not we can get this fired up. So here we are back on the Commodore 64. I've got the PLA in my hand. I'm just going to bob it in the socket. Hopefully this will go in quite easily. Make sure everything's lined up. Push down gently. There we go. Got the PLA back in. A completely populated Commodore 64 board. Next question. Will it fire up? Well, there's only one way to find out, isn't there? Let's put the lid on. I won't screw it up just yet. I will be careful with these. Hooks at the back, which hook the case on, because they do have a tendency to snap. These fellas here. So I'm going to be careful with those. They're intact on this particular board. Case, I mean. So let's close that. So let's get the... I'm going to be doing this off UHF. So let's get the aerial lead plugged in. Find that. There we go. That's in. And I've got the original Commodore 64 power supply DIN plug here. So let's get that plugged in. The moment of truth. So let me get this recording on my other camera. Let's switch it on and find out whether it works. Fingers crossed. Black screen. Boot. Fantastic. Does the keyboard work? Got the right amount of memory. Fantastic. A semicolon on this. Spacebar's a bit sticky. Soon fix that, I think. Job's a good one. Fantastic.
So one of the ways that you can test whether a Commodore 64 is working is with a dead test card. And here's one I prepared earlier. It's basically a Versa 64 card. I've stuck in an EEPROM on there. First 8K of that, I've got a dead test cartridge. I'll just zoom in so you can see the pinouts on that. There we go. In case you decide to make your own, those are the dip switch settings and jumper settings that you require in order to get this working on the Commodore 64. Took me a couple of attempts, to be honest. The software is burnt into the first 8K of this particular cartridge on the ROM. So let's get that in and see whether or not this Commodore 64 passes the dead test. Let's see if I can feel the cartridge port without getting my head in the way. Yep, I think that's it. Let's try that. Oh. That was a noise, wasn't it? Right, let's turn it on. Work out whether or not we fixed this or not. Black screen. Come on, boot. Yay. It's testing zero page. That's the first 256 bytes of RAM. Stat page, whatever that is. My Commodore 64. I see it's testing the screen RAM now. See the character being written down the screen, top to bottom, left to right. Yeah. Modulated output's not bad on this. I found that, I don't know if it's my cable or not, I get varied results depending on how far the coax cable's pushed in, connector's pushed in. It's pushed all the way and it's very blurry. That's the best of being able to get it. It's not bad though, is it? It's better than the Spectrum. It's certainly very good for a 4-year-old machine. So it's testing the colour RAM here. You might just be able to see the colour changing as it goes down the screen. A RAM test. That's quite worrying. I hope that's normal. Hello? Is this broke or not? Talk amongst yourselves, please. Cool. Looks like we've passed. Fantastic. So there we have it. Another machine saved from landfill. And my first Commodore 64. Fantastic. I'm going to enjoy playing with this, I think. It's one of those machines that I probably would have liked to have had as a kid, but my parents couldn't afford it. I certainly couldn't afford to have a Spectrum and a Commodore 64. So yeah, fabulous. I hope you enjoyed watching this video. If you like what I'm doing, then please subscribe to my channel. And I'll see you next time. Thank you.